Please rise and join me with a salute to the flag, please.
Pledge
Pledge
allegiance
allegiance
to the
to the flag
flag of the
of the
United
United
States of
States
America and to
and
the
to the
Republic
Republic
for
for
which
which
it
it stands,
stands,
one
one
nation,
nation, under
under
God,
God,
indivisible,
indivisible,
with
with
liberty
liberty
and
and
justice
justice
for
for
all.
all. Sure. The meeting is now called to order. We have an action item, resolution. March 2024, Incorporated Village of Sag Harbor resolution limiting moorings in the outer management area for the 2024 season. There's a copy of the resolution that was drafted on the table. Do you have any questions from the?
I'm sorry, this is all not rushed, but it's sort of was, but I would like to know who determined that there are 67 moorings at the village.
This was information that was gathered from the harbor master, from his.
And the reason I'm saying this is because there was essentially no control, formal control of the mooring field. So,
Well,
but
that's not true. The harbor master.
there was control of it, but the number of applicants that had come in, we'd never had a limit before because, without passing this resolution, there was no prior limit.
So that means last summer, last season, there were 67 people that applied for mooring permits.
And accepted and were
Word.
awarded. They applied and no one was turned down.
All right, so that's what we're basing the 67 on.
Yes, and they went out, there were at times, and I think it's because so often boats are in and out, people had the impression that it was a much lower number because there wasn't full capacity of boats there all the time.
I mean, another way to say it, there was a 40% utilization rate of the
There's something
moorings.
like that, right?
Exactly. So
60
that's
was the highest or something on the 4th of
50.
July or
That
something.
59, and it was actually Labor Day weekend was the
Right.
peak. And that number was the combination of both boats anchored as well as on moorings.
And
Yes, that was the peak that one Saturday. I believe it was September 2nd. Okay.
one thing that's occurred to me is that we want to make sure we don't disincentivize people from using the mooring field as
100%.
opposing to anchoring, because if it's super expensive, some other reason, let's drop an anchor off of Barcelona, right? And then that's not our jurisdiction anymore. So that's one of these things
And
where
this is a delicate balance that, and so we'll use this summer to really take the time to have every day they would go out and count, but now it's going to be really witnessing how many are anchored. Are we seeing an increase in anchoring from putting the 67 limit? What's the demand initially for these applications? Let's just see, even when that happens, this is the first time we're going to have a $350 fee. Does that impact people? We don't know yet.
Right. So, to that point, have we accepted any applications for this year yet?
No, we've been waiting, and that's
Okay.
really why we need the resolution to be passed so that they can begin the process of accepting applications. And then once the applications are submitted, and they can be, if assuming we would adopt this resolution tonight, the Harbor Masters plan to send out an email to all the people who have applied in the past. It'll be posted. People will have access to it and they can fill out the application. And then by Friday, they will begin to start to award some of the.
This Friday? No.
Yes.
Oh, okay. So again, this is at the Harbor Master's discretion, 100%, right?
Yes.
Okay. There was a policy that I believe Bob and Chris have been working on that we took a look at as to how the moorings will be.
Allocated.
Right.
Allocated.
And as far as I know, no mooring will be allocated unless there's a boat to go along with that mooring. There has to be information on the boat, insurance on the boat, in order for them to allocate a marina,
so
a mooring.
Exactly. So a complete application, meaning that all the documentation is completed with the insurance information, that, you know, it's a license. It's a licensed boat owner, like so all of that.
A single vessel, a single mooring needs to be to get the permit.
Correct.
Yes.
And we all know that.
And the $350 paid.
And we know that they're commercial operators. And it stands to reason that they're in some ways transient. How is that going to work? Like, are they just going to have to come up with the name of a boat? And I don't mean if it's facetious, I'm asking just a procedural question. How do they, if they intend to use it as a transient mooring, how can they assign one boat to it?
That'll be for the initial, at least.
For the initial?
Yes.
And there's policy that's being worked on. I wish the harbor master, one of the harbor masters, was here to explain that.
I'm surprised they're not here.
Well, I want that to be noted in the record that they're not here. But the fact that they're working on a policy that the mooring has to have a boat that is registered, insured, in order to get that mooring, and there's a time frame in which that vessel has to use the mooring. So
a minimum days or
right.
But I would imagine there is going to be some accommodation in that policy for intentionally that not every mooring will be dedicated to one boat throughout the entire season.
Correct.
In certain situations. Somehow
that's
got to be worked.
So
that has to be worked through in that policy.
And that's the way the harbor masters have managed the inside has been if someone knows that they were taking a trip to Nantucket, Block Island, wherever, and they were going to be gone for extended time, they notify the harbor master. Then that way, whether it's a dock slip, an inner mooring, whatever it is, then that can be utilized. And those dates, the harbor master would take it off of the
harbor.
Yes, would be look at the wait list and let people know that they
and
could.
Do we charge for that? For the
yes.
use of those?
Yes.
That's slips too?
Yes.
Inner, outer, and the slips?
Yes, but never outer. This has never been done before in the outer. So that's why we've had that 41% utilization rate, because it was only one person having the rights to that mooring, unless it was a commercial operated transient where they had a schedule and they knew someone was coming for a week. They knew what their calendar looked like for the summer. So that's the thing that's different. And if you look at the numbers that we had from last year, there were, say, no more than 15 that were transient moorings that were out in the outer mooring area. The majority of the 67 were seasonal, so that it was either privately owned or privately owned and managed and serviced by a commercial operator. That's where those individuals could be, you know, spending their summer as they chose and were here, you know.
Come and go as they
exactly. No exact pattern. It was random.
Because one thing that's confusing people, me in particular, is that if there's a mooring, if the mooring is in theory a location, then there's the anchor and the tackle and the rest of that.
Yes.
And so when we talk about a mooring, are we talking about the block of concrete in the ground or the whole thing? In other words, because the servicing part is what gets confusing. Because an individual may come, drop a mooring, set the gear, and then someone comes and ties up to them. So that service person is not the owner of that mooring.
It's very fair to say there are different iterations of how it can be. A private person can own the entire thing, set the entire thing. That's usually unlikely, but the potential is there, right? Generally, they are going to hire a commercial operator to do some part of it. What happens as a operator is you're going to inspect that mooring, all the connections, make sure everything is you know, as they call semen ready, that there's going to be no risk.
Shape.
Right?
Right.
So that process goes on and is often done. You hire someone to do it for you, right? So that's the commercial operator. And they will provide that service, whether it's adding all the different pieces, making sure everything's airtight. And then even maybe you're only out here in the month of July. So from April 1 through October 31st, this person who you've hired to service your mooring is going to be taking care of it and making sure.
You know, that's like, you know, a gray area, but that's, I understand, when taking care of it means
checking your boat, making sure things are
checking the boat. Mm-hmm. And that could send to that liability.
Which is why they have to have the insurance. Exactly.
Right. And so that the owner of the vessel, whoever puts the gear in the ground, is still liable. In other words, let's say a mooring fails for some reason, or chain breaks, or something lets loose. Whose liability is that? The boat owner or the person that set the mooring?
On the privately owned ones where they are providing their insurance, then it will go to that private owner. On the commercially operated ones where it could be where it's transient, it's the responsibility of the commercial operator. And that's why we see that they have the higher insurance.
Right. So then in this application process, I don't mean to hog this, by the way, but we're almost done. In this application process, you distinguish between commercial, private, transient, whatever the categories would be?
Yes.
Like
we have now.
We're resolving to limit the number to 67. The harbor master is coming up with a policy to implement how those 67 are allocated. So I don't know if you have a copy of it or if they're still working on it. From what I discussed with the harbor master, and we discussed, is that the transient moorings would be put back into the number of 60. In other words, there would be no transient moorings.
It depends on
commercial transient moorings that they would be. You'd have to have a boat registration and insurance for each mooring. Now, that doesn't mean that if you have a customer, and this is all theory now because the harbor master is not here to explain this. If you have a boat that's hooked up to a mooring, so a certain commercial entity allocates this mooring to a certain boat, the boat is there, but it's not there all the time. Part of the time it's away, then that mooring obviously can be used for transient purposes. The boat is gone for 2 weeks or 3 weeks, that commercial operator can use that mooring to commercial.
So then transient equals commercial.
Yes.
But yes. Because
yes.
If you have a mooring.
Yes, there's no transients that are
private. No personal transient moorings. So that's a way to reallocate the number of moorings that are out there in a fair way. In other words,
or another way of saying it's another way to fully utilize
the
limited numbers of
moorings
that are out there over the course of a season.
Because this is the first time we've ever had to limit.
But Bob makes a good point as far as, you know, anchoring a mooring. The mooring, if the mooring, and I happen to believe in the eco-friendly moorings. I think they're better for the bottom of the harbor. There's some of them out there. They've been tested, and some of them aren't as strong as others. We talked to a harbor master who had come up with this system that he's tried and tested, and it seems to be working very well. But that's something that we're going to have to plan for in the future.
So actually, could I just read a statement that I wrote to just try to kind of summarize the process that we've been going through over the last months? So the initial goal of this proposal, or the initial proposal, was to establish a limit on the number of vessels permitted in the outer mooring area, and to organize the layout using GPS locations, taking into account the size of vessels while being sensitive to the location of eelgrass beds to promote and preserve water quality. Given the input we received from all the stakeholders in the workshop, it became apparent that we will need more time for proposing changes to the code. We hope to adopt a resolution to limit the number of moorings to 67 just for this season of 2024. And that number was the number that we had from last year. Without this resolution, there would be no limit on the number of moorings. This will be an ongoing process that the Board of Trustees and the Harbor Masters will assess the number of vessels anchored, the demand and usage for moorings on a daily basis. So therein lies the part where we're going to stay on top of it. We will also continue to have the water quality tested regularly and monitor the condition of the eelgrass beds. It's a complex balancing act. We will look to best satisfy the multiple goals and parties that at times may seem conflicting. However, the same goal to protect, preserve, and enjoy the village's prized resource, the bay, I believe is the same for all the parties. We'll continue to gather feedback from our residents, boat owners, and the commercial operators, along with the science gained from our partners, Dr. Gobler of SUNY Stony Brook, the Peconic Baykeepers, the Blue Water Task Force Water Quality Monitoring Program, the Cornell Co-op, and the Friends of Havens Beach. We will also continue to study the new technology, such as the eco-friendly moorings equipment, and we will be discussing these options with the Army Corps of Engineers, as well as fellow harbor masters who have installed different versions of the eco moorings. We will review all the results that we will receive. So the other key piece that we are looking to change for this season, which will not be in this resolution, but it was an outcome from the workshop. We're going to start a pilot program where the harbor masters will introduce and distribute new orange ties that are numbered and labeled. The label will be SHVHM. These will be handed out for the vessel's Y valves. The harbor masters will also distribute the cards reminding all boat owners that the Peconic Estuary is a no dump area. The harbor masters will instruct the boat, the yacht owner, captain, who is responsible for the Y value, what the process will be. The harbor master and the pump up boat will record the number and they'll know what it should be. If a boat leaves our area where they can go out and they're beyond the point, the 3 mile point, where they can legally dump, the boat owner slash captain will need to request a new tie from the harbor master upon return. This is the way we can continue to keep control of this. And if you look at the recommendation from Dr. Gobler, he said, if we can continue, the vessels are there, we know they're a part of it, but if we can regulate them, we will do so. We will also continue to have the coordinated MSD inspections where we work with the East End Task Force. So those are members of the New York DEC, the Coast Guard, Southampton and East Hampton Marine Patrols, and Suffolk County Sheriff's Office. And then our harbor masters themselves will increase their number of inspections. We hope this will help to better identify what sources are really impacting our water quality. And after the summer, after we can gather all this information, and we will then share all our findings and come up with a recommendation in a future workshop before finalizing any changes to the code for the 2025 season.
Thank you for that. And before we go to the audience, very thorough, very complete. I just would like to get one more thing to be added to that. That
sure.
As part of the assessment, that you know, what also came out in the workshop is that the costs that we're charging for this don't necessarily reflect the cost of administering the outer mooring field. And so if we could assess that over the course of this year too for next year.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, this has to entail like a harbor master or two, or 2 hours a day.
Yeah. Well, essentially, they're monitoring.
It's on average, it's about 45 minutes on a daily basis for one harbor master. If we're going to be increasing inspections, we have to have two harbor masters on the boat, one to stay on the harbor master's boat, one to board what vessel's being inspected. So we can just do the math and we will do that assessment. And that'll be a part of the analysis that we'll put together and share with everyone.
The cost. houses.
Exactly.
Can you have like one of the dock hands steer the boat and have one of the harbor masters go out there?
Stuff can be assessed over the course of this year by the harbor masters.
Trustee Corish has a question.
I would just like to add, first of all, I'd like to thank Trustee Kane for all the work she's done on this. It's a voyage of discovery, so to speak. And I think what's being proposed today is a wonderful start. And I want everybody to appreciate that having these color-coded ties for the Y vowels is an enormous step forward. I think it's going to pay dividends. I think everybody will step up and use them. It's important for our water. And more than anything else, it will allow us to get really good data this summer, because it's only with good data that we can make informed decisions as to what the best way forward is. So I fully support this. I'm sorry I can't be with you, but I got another job too. But I'd just like to thank Trustee Kane for all the work she's done on this.
Thank you. Thank you, Trustee Corish. Mr. Scheel?
Hi, everybody. We're back. First off, I think it's great that we're doing
for the record, I'm sorry, could you just keep naming it?
Jimmy Scheel, Zach Harvey Yacht Yard. I think it's great that we're doing this. Preserving our waterways, focusing on the environment, what's going on around us. I have to make a correction. The correction I have with me is the total mooring count for the Sag Harbor Yacht Yard for last year and 5 previous years. The issue here is the number 5 was given on page 7 of the Dock Masters or Harbor Masters presentation last week. 5 is the total number of moorings that I have outside the seawall that are on winter stakes. That is not the total number of moorings that we have in the water every year.
Wait, can I just ask one question though? Do you mean in the outer mooring region?
Outer mooring region. We have 5 out there right now that are on winter stakes because they're brand new. So instead of disturbing the seabed and pulling them out, we left them in. When he asked me how many moorings are out there, I told him 5. Because 5 is what's out there right now. It's not what I pulled out this season. In front of you, on page 7 from the presentation that I printed out correctly, the number 22 is written above the number 5. 22 is the total number of moorings that the Sag Harbor Yacht Yard has had out there. Behind this page, you'll have 2019, 2020, all the way to 2023. Highlighted in the upper right-hand corner is the number of Port Maria, outside the Port Maria and the outside seawall, number of moorings that the yacht yard has had in that area. So for each year, you'll see a number for Port Maria and the highlighted year in the corner. And if you flip through, 11, 13, 20, 23, 22, and then 22 again for this year. Those have been the numbers. We have not changed any numbers. These are the numbers that we have with the same customers. These are the same contracts that we've already sent out. We've already received feedback from our customers for the 22 moorings. We've already taken deposit for them. We were asking for 32. As you see, I crossed out the number 32 for proposed number 24 for the 24 year. 32 was us asking for 10 more, not jumping from 5 to 32, but jumping from 22 to 32. I'm asking, but it's fine if we keep it the same. I was asking for 3 more to apply them as transient moorings, which I put a little asterisk in the bottom of the first page here and said that I was asking for 3 more moorings.
I'm not going to make any changes. I'm not going to get into how the Harbor Master is going to allocate the 67 spots.
Right.
He has a policy and he's going to implement it. It's at his discretion.
Right.
At the moment, I told you parts of it, that there has to be a vessel attached to the mooring.
So, and that's the thing. So all these 22 that we have a vessel attached to them. They've had a vessel attached to them for the last 5 years. I can pull up more records and show you more vessels attached to the moorings, and the count fluctuates. There were years we had 30-something out there. There were years when we had 11 out there. There were years when there were 4. There were years when there were 40.
All right.
I don't know how far back into the records you want me to go.
Do you have any experience with the eco-friendly moorings?
I've been reading up on
them.
So two things happened this year, which have been, it's been an exciting year for us. First off, it's my first year here. Love the town. Village is awesome. This has been fun. Our mooring boat sank. And it sank with me on board. I spoke to you about that. We are investing in the future of this village, this waterfront community. I read the LWRP twice now. There's a lot going on in there, and there's a lot that says it is protecting commercial operators and also for the good of the environment and so on. With the purchase of our new mooring boat for this season and the moorings we've already purchased to replace, so we got rid of more than half of our mushroom anchors, which are probably the most unfriendly anchor you could be using. They drag, they slide, they roll, and I've replaced them with what's more eco-friendly, which is a pyramid-style anchor.
The Dormoor.
The Dormoor.
Yep.
Which once it's set in the ground, doesn't move. So now I have 240K into a brand new mooring boat, and I just shelled out over $70,000 into Dormoors in particular, just to put into your outer mooring fields. I still have mushrooms. I'm putting them elsewhere. But because we're so concerned with the sea bottom, I'm making sure that our new equipment goes into the place where you are most concerned about. So now I have 70K into equipment, and I'm concerned that the numbers are so wrong that we're going to get kind of railroaded here to five, which is so not true. And provided handed you are the records of our last 5 years. So
like
if you do the count and you factor in the numbers I just gave you, the mooring count outside should be 83 or 84, not 67. And I'm sorry that was my mistake with answering the Harbor Master's question incorrectly, but I had no idea what he meant by what you have outside. I thought he meant what was currently in the water.
But but we have these records. These are records you
Those
got
are
from
my
our,
records I provided.
So we'll have to match them with
To
us.
Match.
Right.
So
to match them with ours.
And you can match the numbers, and it's all there, and the owners' names are there, and where they're located, and so on. And it also shows you my entire mooring count for what's from.
Can I make
we do Robbins Islands out to Montauk.
Right.
But yeah.
Can I make a suggestion?
I just wanted to clarify this because that's to go from 22 to 5.
Can I make a suggestion?
Yeah.
That we verify with the Harbor Masters the mooring counts, how the mooring counts are determined for last year. Our intent is not to increase the account from last year.
No, and I'm not looking to increase the count. I'm looking to keep it the same.
I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
So we've got two sets of facts that we need to reconcile. What was actually there last year versus what we may or may not have in the count. And just once we reconcile this, I think we can still go ahead and pass this resolution. If it turns out the count that we have in this resolution is wrong, we can adjust that account. I don't expect we're going to allocate 67 moorings out in the first week.
No.
No, of course. And that's the other problem I have. I'm not going to get my mooring boat to the 1st of May being built right now. So I'm already behind as it is, which is terrifying enough that I won't be able to rush out there, which I don't want to do.
Mm-hmm.
The last thing I want to do is see this be like some kind of gold rush where we're all panicking to get out there to claim our spot.
We all have the same objective on that.
Yes.
Okay. That's a serious concern.
Yep.
And then the other thing I wanted to address, in the presentation last week, it showed a very good picture, and I have copies of it here if you want to see it. And just last page, not the first page, this is just the 1983 laws on top. The very last page is a picture of the harbor. Thank you.
No pictures.
In that picture, it's also taken from.
Sorry, but there's no picture.
No picture.
Whoa. Okay. There's a picture.
In the very back, did I hand the wrong one? I'm so sorry. Hang on. Gave the wrong thing out. So that's just a look. My bad. Sorry, guys. Here we go. Navigation law 46A.
46A, yep.
Yep, 46A. This is a good one. So that's just the 1983 law. I'm sorry about that. I was doing a lot of research today.
Yep.
Navigation law 46A states, here you go, you guys, no problem, that the village has control over the waterways 1,500 feet from the median high tide mark.
Mm-hmm.
Stated more than once, stated in the LWRP.
Mm-hmm.
If you flip to the harbor management area, there is a red dotted line across the bottom. That is the 1,500 foot mark.
Yes.
So how are we going about regulating what goes on outside of what technically is your jurisdiction?
So
how does that work?
So New York State authorized Sag Harbor masters
mm-hmm.
to have the responsibility to manage from the 15 out to the 4,000 because they knew that boats were mooring in our outer mooring area and New York State did not have the manpower to do it. And so that authorization was provided, or was the jurisdiction to manage it, was authorized by New York State.
Gotcha. So I was on the phone with New York State today and I contacted the Department of Underwater Land and I'm trying to say this correctly because they have so many acronyms. Spoke to them on the phone and they said verbatim, the only code and law for this is code 46A. And that is the only law that would actually be governable. So I'm just trying to understand how, after 1,500 feet, we're able to stop, unless it's zoned as preserving yellow grass or some kind of environmental issue. I don't see exactly, I'm not saying we're going to go out there and throw 500 moorings out there. I'm looking for the same number we've had year after year after year. And I'm really concerned that the numbers are wrong. And that I have customers.
If you have a question about how we're implementing this, we'll take it up with our attorney.
Okay.
Because there is a law.
Two different issues. I'm sorry. There's the issue of the law, and as was explained to you, that New York State has granted us the right. It doesn't change the law. They've granted us the right to regulate. Right. Not the law. That's the regulation. That's one.
Yeah.
The first issue you raised was a factual issue about how many moorings were issued or were out there last year, year before.
And utilized.
We've got two different sets of facts that we said we would look into to reconcile those facts.
Okay.
Two separate issues.
And I can give you this too. Out of the 22 that we've had out there, I mean, if they're even on there for more than a month at a time, it ranges. I get it. But like I was explaining last meeting that we had, the boats that come in are all different sizes. And they're being used at different times because they're different sizes. And they're all different weights and they're all set differently because of that.
So what's on the table right now is this resolution for us to pass limiting the number to 67.
Yes.
Okay. As far as the way that those 67 are implemented is up to the harbor master's discretion. That's the way it's written. That's the way the law is written. The code is written. So any of these questions that come up that you have, you'd have to address them to the harbor master.
Okay.
All right. If you feel that there's a problem with the law, we can get clarification for you.
Right. So how do we clarify that the number of 67 is incorrect from the last 5 years to this year?
So
how do we fix that?
We will. Well,
you're saying it's incorrect.
We are absolutely going to look into that, but we're not going to look into it right now.
Right.
But we will look at it after today.
But if we're voting on 67, I'm just curious how we go about doing that because I didn't really have any time to prepare.
As I just said to you earlier,
okay,
we're going to vote on 67 today. That's the resolution before us. We'll look to verify the facts after today.
Okay.
And then we might revisit the 67.
These are in or in, right?
Cormorita is the ones that are outside, and also in that list is other areas.
I said they were separate, but now I understand. Right. It's more than 67.
We've got some factual analysis to do.
Yeah.
Not here.
So on that, if you're looking at that page, the ones that are labeled down the list that say Cormorita are the ones that are the outers. The ones that say FH next one are the ones that we have that were in. And then those are also, that's my entire, so when I printed that, that's just my spreadsheet for everything we do from Robbins Island out to Montauk. So I gave you my entire print off from year to year because there's nothing changed because it's been the same.
So one thing that might be helpful to speed up the analysis is for you to give us not what you have in other places, not what's in the inner, solely what's in the outer, so that we can see if that matches where we know that you were issued a permit to have a mooring in the outer. So, you know, we appreciate that you've been here just for a year. You're still gathering the information. Just as we are doing a change, we're gathering the information, and it all takes time to do it correctly. And everyone wants to do it correctly. So it would be very helpful, I think, if you could, as I said, just show us what you know so we can match it, and then we can get an answer much more quickly.
I can totally cut out everything else tomorrow and send it to you if you want. I'll just give you a cut out version of everything.
That would be great.
Okay. This is just a very quick thing up until the other day. I just knew this meeting was coming and I just did everything I could to prepare. This was done in the last couple hours, so please bear with me. I'm sorry.
It's, no, we appreciate it.
About this. I'm just trying to
We're just trying to get the right facts, too.
So, isn't his 3 minutes up?
Who's that?
I don't know.
I said Steve Williams said it. Isn't it 3 minutes up? Can we move on to somebody else?
Steve, I'm running the meeting.
I'm sorry, but
if I need you to help me, I'll ask for it, but I appreciate that. So we have the resolution has been proposed. Do I have a motion to adopt?
Wait, I guess we need to ask, is there anyone?
Anybody else that has any questions?
Mr. Morris has questions.
Okay, hang on. Trustee Plum's got another issue he wants to raise.
Well, I just have a general statement.
Right.
Okay.
And that is that the benefit of eco moorings, as they're so called, is the fact that a line from the mooring to the vessel floats.
Yes.
It's that simple.
Yes.
The mooring itself is a factor, but much less so than the chain drag.
From what I've been told from the harbor, I'm not going to mention his name, from a harbor master that used these, experimented with different eco moorings and came up with the system that he found was reliable.
Tackle that works.
Was that the it's a coil.
It's a helix. It's a helix
coil,
anchor.
Goes into the anchors into the bottom.
Right.
That he's seen it where the grass has grown right over the top of it.
Yeah. Well, that's part of it. But the bigger part is
right.
The fact that the chain doesn't drag.
Never touches the bottom. That's what he said. It never touches the bottom.
Make sure it's okay.
Okay. So Lisa had a question. Comment.
Lisa,
Jason Morris.
Thank you, Lisa Stenson Desimores, president of Sag Harbor Hills Improvement Association, 17 Hillside Drive West. On behalf of our Sag Harbor HBBC, I want to applaud Mayor Gardella and the trustees for this resolution that will cap the number of moorings for the 2024 summer season. That said, I do have just four questions. If you would indulge me, please. This is all also from experience of an uncle who owned a 60-foot J-Series sailboat, sailed from Florida to Martha's Vineyard, including stops in Sag Harbor, dating back to the late 70s. So will there be a cap on the number of anchorings in the outer management area which cause more disruption to the bay's ecosystem than the moorings? That's question number one. Question number two, will there be a cap on the number of vessels that are 85 feet and longer among the 67 moorings? That's question number two. Question number three, will there be a cap on the maximum size of vessels that may be moored in the outer management area? That's question number three. And then question number four is, I heard that dumping is permitted 3 miles from the shore. Is that from the Sag Harbor Bay, Marcelona Point, and Shelter Island?
Montauk.
It's out in the ocean.
It's out.
All right.
Yeah.
From the international.
The entire Peconic Bay area is a no-discharge zone.
Okay. Well, okay. That's on the other side.
No.
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 This is Peconic Bay.
Where we are?
Yep.
Okay.
It's part of it, yes.
All right.
I think Gardner's Bay is as well.
So are we down to three questions? Lisa has one, I guess.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
The only thing that I can comment on is the size. Like there's a physical limit as far as draft and how big a vessel can actually go into that outer mooring field. I don't know what the technical length of it is. These are all questions I think for the harbor master.
Right, it would both be a combination of the length and the draft. Some of the newer made vessels have less draft, so they could be some that might be 100 feet long. But again, these are technical questions and we would have to have the harbor master or technical person to be answering that question. Your question about, is there a cap on the maximum size or is there a cap on the anchoring? And at the moment, no. This year this season because there wasn't enough time to do all the necessary data gathering, that this year will be a year that we could issue this resolution that could put a cap on the number to be moored. As far as anchoring, you know, this is where you do get into the LWRP, that people can come and they can anchor. This is the work that we're going to be doing, and this is what we hope to be recommending and coming up with the right answer with the combination of everyone, just the same as we've done here. But we need that time. We could issue the maximum for the moorings. That was it.
So as of this point today, the only thing we're capping is the number of moorings in the outer mooring fields. The other issues you've raised, Lisa, are issues we will continue to look at, but we're not capping those today, size or amount of anchoring. I think in the presentation we saw at the workshop, there's a balancing act to be struck between moorings, and we don't want to encourage a lot of anchoring either. So we understand that balance has to be struck, but we don't have enough data to put a cap on that either at this point, or any other way of addressing that at this point.
Can you, for this season, restrict the area for anchoring?
I think this map, the map of the harbor management area, does designate.
But we're not allowed to.
But the short answer is no.
Not at this time, please.
Yes.
And the problem is that outside of the line, you're allowed to anchor.
Mm-hmm.
That's not our jurisdiction. Out by Barcelona and out that way towards the lighthouse, it's state land and it's not under our control. Is that correct?
Yes. So this is why we continue to do the work to see what we could and where we could put a cap, and then realistically how we can enforce things. So these are the things that we still need to go through, and we need to take our time to do it the right way and to be working with all the stakeholders, as I mentioned. But it's all the things that we've looked at. We are looking at it. So don't think we are in any way dismissing it. We are trying to be thoughtful.
Understood.
Thank you.
Steve has a question.
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Williams is raising his hand.
Go ahead. Steve. Are you there, Steve?
Yes, I'm here now. First of all, I do apologize for my prior outbreak, but I thought that the trustees had answered that question a couple times. There was a question about, in the earlier discussion, about the location of the larger boats and kind of a request that they be close to the navigational channels, particularly the north channels. And I'm just wondering if that had been considered in this resolution.
We absolutely
not in this resolution
looked at it, but not in this resolution, because that will be changes. And as you know, we're also trying to minimize movement of anything that could impact the bottom land for this season. These will be things that we'll be looking at for the future season, Steve, and we are well aware of the request and understand it.
Thank you.
Also, those things are code changes which require hearings, notices, resolutions.
New York State approval.
Usually 3 to 4 months worth of stuff. Yeah. So we can do because it's in the code already.
Yes.
Correct. Anybody else have any questions? Steve, is that all you have?
Yes, that's all. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Shannon Richards has a question.
Okay. Hi, folks. I just want to say thank you. I figured I probably took way enough time the last time, so I'll keep things briefer this time and try to average that out. To Trustee Kane and to all the trustees, forgive me, I don't know everybody's name, and to Mayor Gardella. Just thank you. And one last sincere offer. I had the privilege under the last administration to be an active participant with the EAC. For personal reasons, I've taken a step back from that with Marianne's support, but my commitment to the Bay and to this village remain. And so in honor of my father and to many Richards who have come before me, who have always been more a part of tackling problems, but also bringing effort to the solution. While the village, I'm sure, will need to do its own research, if there are things that can be parsed out to anybody else to help, Google searches, code enforcement, text rundowns, whatever, I offer my aid, not only as a property owner, representative of a five-generation family in Azurest, but more so as an invested party into the water quality and the health and the prosperity of our village. So that is the short version from me. Appreciate you giving me a couple minutes to say it. But if there's anything that I personally can do to assist as a representative of my community and as a member of this village, I would like to. And please don't hesitate to ask. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shannon. Anybody else?
No.
So as I stated, we have the resolution before us. Do I have a motion?
I'll move.
Motion by Trustee Plum. Do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Trustee Kane. The motion, the resolution is adopted. Oh, wait, all those in favor?
Aye.
The resolution is adopted. Do you have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Motion by Trustee Kane. Second.
Second.
Seconded by Deputy Mayor Hay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Meeting is adjourned.
Thank you.